All right, so welcome everybody again. It's been a glorious week, and it's an honor and a privilege for everyone here online, on YouTube, Facebook, everywhere that the Word of God is being proclaimed. Thank you for joining us, Body of Christ Bible Fellowship welcomes you. And as we get started, I'd like to read off a couple of announcements for the week. First off, again, our next community mission event is going to be on October 31st. That's a Saturday. It's Halloween. We're collecting clothes, winter clothing right now for anyone in the community that may be in need. We will have some sort of meal that night as well. So for anybody that is listening today or here right now, be on the lookout for warm winter clothes, because we know people in our community are in need during this hard time. Let's see. Also, Bible study on Thursdays. Again, if you're in the neighborhood of Lawrenceburg and you want to join us, come out to Davy Crockett State Park and turn off on the first left there, and we will be in that pavilion or picnic tables off there for our Bible study this week, and we'll be finishing the book of John. So again, join us with that. It would be a truly a blessing for everyone that comes out. It really is. If you have any prayer requests or any prayer needs at all, if you hear anything today, song, Word of God, anything that stirs you in your spirit, send an email to boc_BibleFellowship@iCloud.com. We have a committed ministry team here at this church that pray over those issues daily. So again, use that resource that's available and send those emails in to us so we can pray for you as well. That truly is a blessing to each and every single one of us. Lastly, our YouTube channel, Body of Christ Bible Fellowship. You can go there, subscribe, and rewatch any of our services from any Sunday at your own discretion. That's also a resource that's available to you. So again, there's the resources, as we begin, as we do every week, we will start with the Lord's Supper. Brother Grady, would you be so kind as to help us this morning? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Father, everybody's bow our heads. Father God, we just come to you in Jesus' name. And Lord, you've heard these prayer requests this morning, these praise reports, Lord, and we just lift them up to you, Lord, as you and you only can know what to do with these, Lord. And we just praise your holy name. We thank you for this time to get to fellowship together, Lord, and to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Lord, we just pray for our country and our leaders right now. As Lord, as you know, we're just in we believe that with our hearts that it's in the end time tribulations coming to pass, possibly, Lord, and only you know. But Lord, we just lift up our country and the whole world to you, Lord, and you know what needs are out there. And Lord, we pray for this upcoming community outreach program, Lord, and we just ask that you'd be in the center of it, and you would lead whoever needs to stop by, Lord, and that they could get a touch from you and just feel your love. And Lord, we just pray for our pastor this morning. We just ask that you just speak through him, Lord, and Lord, that he would just reach whoever it needs to be reached, Lord, and that you would just touch us, Lord. And we thank you for this time to get together. And Lord, we pray for this communion this morning, Lord, and we just ask that each person take it in a way that would be pleasing to you. And Lord, we just ask that you bless it. And Father, we love you and we adore you, and we just praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. So our scripture for communion this morning, will be out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. And the thing to remember while we're taking this communion, Jesus gives a teaching over this while he was alive, before he died on the cross. In John chapter 6, verse 48, he's speaking to the people that he's just fed, 5,000 to be exact, grown men, women and children with five loaves and two fish. And Jesus proclaims, "I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and died, but this is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one that may eat will not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." So that's Jesus' teaching, foreshadowing communion that is to come. And that is what we are partaking of this morning. And again, the scriptures tell us to examine ourselves, to look into ourselves and not to come falsely to this, to be remembrance of Jesus and what he's done on the cross, but also that he's coming back. And that he is going to return to collect his church. And that is also, that those are the two critical things right there as we take the Lord's Supper, is that we remember what he did, that he suffered the wrath of God so that we didn't have to. But then we also remember that he's coming back to get us. See, even in the midst of all of this, Jesus is going to come back. And when that day comes, oh, what a glorious day it'll be. What a glorious day it will be. So, again, if you want to join us, it truly, truly is a blessing. So, we will begin this morning with the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. Paul is writing to the churches in Corinth about the ordinance of the Lord's Supper, and he's teaching them how to partake of it correctly. So, in verse 23, the Bible says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Thank you, Lord Jesus. "After the same manner, also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink in remembrance of me." Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And then in verse 26 says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes." So praise God. Praise God. Thank you. Move into the next portion here. We want to welcome everybody to join with us in singing a few spiritual hymns and songs to just welcome the Holy Spirit's presence among us and to just invite him to come and dwell in our hearts.
Beautiful name it is, the name. people living with HIV, keep being you and ask your doctor about the TARP. Big TARP?
The look on her face when that popped up. Oh, she was like.
Are you disappointed? Are you desperate for the help? You know what it's like to be tired and only a shell of yourself.
Yes.
Will you start to believe you don't have what it takes?
Jesus, what a wonderful name it is.
Yes.
The
yes.
name of Jesus.
Amen.
And we are almost home. I know in our current state, in our current society, that kind of gets taken out of focus a little bit.
Yep.
We find ourselves busy all the time, and everything lobbies for our attention. When really, in all actuality, we should just come into a stronger and more intimate relationship with
Amen.
God.
Amen.
That is what each one of us are created for.
Yes.
Is there is a hole inside of you that will and can only be filled with the love of God.
Amen.
That's it. Yeah. That is the only way to fill it. Now, man will spend a lot of time trying to fill that hole with other men.
Yep.
Food, drugs, sex, music, entertainment, you name it. There's all kinds of things out there that the enemy wants us to use to fill that hole that only the love of God can fit into.
That's right, brother.
And that's the agonizomai, is to agonize, is to drop those things, to get into that narrow gate. That's why. It's because only the love of God will allow you to fit.
Amen.
You know, it's the only thing that fits in your heart. And that's the way we were created. So our scripture today is going to be out of the book of Jeremiah. The book of Jeremiah, chapter 9, verse 24. Chapter 9, verse 24. Just hit me with an amen when you get there. Jeremiah, chapter 9, verse 24.
I just put it up there.
Chapter 9, verse 24. Again, in a world of just busyness, we should truly focus on one relationship that is critical. Absolutely critical. Fundamentally critical to all the way down to our inner being. Is that you cannot you're not completely human without the love of God. That's amazing, right? Like, that's just the way we were made. Without the love of God in your heart, you're actually less human than you are when you have the love of God present. So, about this relationship with God. In Jeremiah chapter 9, actually starting in verse 23, actually, the Bible says, "Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts, boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will punish all those who are circumcised merely in the flesh." That's a lot, right?
Yes.
Taking, that's a lot right there in that relationship. But let's look at the warning first, that the days are coming to where I will punish all those who are merely circumcised in the flesh. Now that is a reference to the circumcision that was given to a child on the eighth day to signify that he was a Jew. So that he's making a reference to religion is what he's talking about right there. That if you were merely circumcised in your flesh and not circumcised in your heart, because that's where the true circumcision actually happens, is in your heart.
Yes.
Amen.
So this relationship right here, that let the man not boast in wisdom, thus says the Lord, the wise man boast in his wisdom, and that is something that happens so much today. We get into chaos, we get into storms of life, and we will immediately go to our wisdom, to our thinking. We'll think, man, I can fix this. I know what I can do, or I'm just going to rely on other people's wisdom to help better my situation. But God says that wisdom, you know, the fear of God is the beginning of all wisdom.
Amen.
In Proverbs. So without God, we can't even have wisdom.
Amen.
So this relationship with God is more than just saying, "I love you, God."
Yes,
it is.
You got to get close to Him.
Yes.
You got to get near to Him. You got to pursue Him, brothers and sisters. I want to give a warning this morning I don't think that I would be doing you justice if I did not. This relationship that we talk about this morning will be the difference between those who spend eternity with Him and those who spend eternity in judgment.
That's right.
And that is the important thing right there, is that there is a hell.
Yes, there is.
And people will be there. People are there right now.
Yes.
There's angels right there that for one reason or another, they didn't go to earth. They did something so bad, God chained them up in hell right now.
Yes.
Come on.
Now they seen Jesus. You know what I mean? They got to see Jesus. He went down there and said, give me the keys of death. I'm taking this.
Yeah.
And then took the captives captive and went to heaven. Praise God.
Yes. Yeah.
But this relationship right here with God, it needs to be a part of our very fabric of our being.
Amen.
Everything we do. So wisdom needs to incorporate God.
Yes.
Let not the mighty man boast in his might. How many times in our culture do we think that we've got the strength or the power to fix something?
Right.
Or to help ourselves? You know what I mean?
Like
it could be something as simple as me picking up this watch, or it could be something as big as me thinking I have the power to save someone's life.
Yeah.
Either way, all power belongs to God.
Amen.
Without God, we can become idolaters. We can turn that power, that strength that we think so highly about, we can actually make that our God.
Yeah. Yes.
So again, God wants to be a part of your wisdom, a part of your strength. And what else does He want to be a part of? Let not the rich man boast in his riches, but let him who boast in this. So don't worry so much about your riches of the world.
That's right.
God says that not one sparrow falls to the ground without Him approving it, and that every hair on your head is accounted for.
Amen.
And during this time right now, there is so much going on that this chaos that consumes us can take our eyes off the ball.
That's right.
Psalm 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I am God."
Amen.
Praise God. There it is right there. That's how you get to know God right there. You incorporate Him into every single aspect of your life. Now, when you do that, what are the things that we should be boasting in? You know what I mean? Because we can go out and proclaim some things.
Yeah.
So what are some things that we can boast in? But let him who boasts in this, that he understands and knows me.
Yes.
God is not some faraway being that we cannot know.
That's right.
We can know the heart of God.
Yes.
We can experience Him. We can feel His presence.
Yes.
When Paul's walking around, he tells the people of the church in Corinth when he's explaining to them about leaving pagan practices and their idols that they've been worshiping to. He says, "Hey, not only," he tells them not to do it because, and they're saying, "Well, if there's only one God, what's the harm in us praying to the rain god or something?" And he says, "Well, because there's actually demons there that are receiving those prayers. So don't do that." But he does make another comment. He says, "But those prayers are to dumb idols." And what he's talking about, he's not talking about intellect. He's talking about the fact that those idols can't talk back.
Amen.
Praise God. You don't serve a God that don't talk back. Praise God. He speaks to us through His creation. He does. You can feel His presence right now. Right now you can feel His presence. And He always reaching, maybe not always, answers us in the way we want.
That's right.
But He always answers us.
Yes, He does.
But you have to understand there is an attempt by the enemy to disrupt that communication.
Yes.
Understand that there's a fight going on.
Yes.
And that when those prayers go up, the altar of incense inside the temple, that is the prayers of the saints.
Yes.
They go up like the incense inside the temple. And God receives those prayers. But the enemy, he wants to try and put a dome on it and block those prayers going up.
Yeah.
He's going to try and disrupt you. He's going to try and get you thinking about your own thinking. He's going to get you thinking about your power and your riches and all of those things.
Mm-hmm.
And you take your mind off God. Be still.
Yes.
And know that And then at the end of Psalm 46:10, it says, "I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in all the earth." Yep. So be still and know that I am God. And then God, he says, he proclaims, I will be exalted to all the nations and to all the earth, praise God. So again, as we move forward into this conversation today, again, remember, warning is the title of this warning. You should tremble at what is coming.
That's right.
I promise you. I'd like to think of myself as somewhat of an intellectual human being, and that I can rationalize just like the best of them. But if you don't hear anything else that I say today, heed this warning with everything that you have. Because there is a time coming to where the heavens will open.
That's right.
And the door will close.
Amen.
And then there is no more time to play this game. There is no more time to get in the door. There's no more time to accept this truth. And there's nothing more terrifying than to think about being on the outside of that door.
Yeah. Yes.
There is nothing more terrifying than to be on the outside of that door. So this relationship that we have with God, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in all the earth. Did you know that justice, or injustice for that matter, proclaims, it cries out to God for justice? So when you think to yourself, oh man, somebody's done me wrong, and I just cannot stand it, it seems like God is just letting the unjust go. He's not. The injustice that you have served actually proclaims, it shouts to God. And that's why he tells us, leave room for my wrath.
Yes.
So he will take care of it because he is just, praise God.
Yes,
and steadfast love. Ain't that great to know the God of the universe loves us in such a way that he will never be moved from that love.
Amen.
Never. He is steadfast. He digs in to that love. He is not going to move. He is in us. He is a part of us. And he, again, digs in with his Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ. Yeah. He lives inside of us when we have faith in what Jesus done on the cross.
Amen.
And if you've never actually came to Jesus and proclaimed him to be your Lord, your God, I want to urge you today to heed this message with caution.
Yes.
Please.
Yes.
Please. So, when we think about these days, because God gives us a way to kind of see what season we're living in, what quarter we're in it, for those that like basketball and football, what quarter of the game are we in? When Jesus came, he said, these are the last days.
Yep.
So I look at that as the first quarter of history. And then you can kind of look and gauge all the way through there and see where we're at now. But in the Word of God, in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 3-4. I know we're going to bounce a couple of times today, y'all, but it's for a good reason. It's for a good reason.
Second
Peter chapter 3, verses 3-4. Second Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 3. Peter, the Apostle Peter, knowing this first of all, in the last days scoffers will come, scoffing, following their own sinful desires. They will say, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation. Now Peter goes on down and reveals to us that pretty much what these men would do in the last days is that they would discredit the flood. They would find a way to discredit the flood. So if you need a box to check, no, that box got checked off in 1844.
Amen.
With the introduction of evolution and Darwinism, which is a complete and utter lie.
Yep.
Paul tells us in Romans that since what is known about God, that is his invisible attributes, his divine nature and eternal power, have been clearly seen since the beginning or since the creation of the world through all that has been made. So mankind is without excuse. You can literally look at the world and you have to at least acknowledge that this did not come from nothing. Your DNA itself has over 3 billion parts of information just on your DNA.
Yeah.
To tell an eye to be an eye, to tell a leg to be a leg, or a frog to be a frog, or a human to be a human. But in the days of Noah, there it is again right there. Jesus tells us to be aware of when we enter back into the days of Noah. So the discrediting of the flood, that's the first thing they're going to go after.
Yeah.
And then they're going to, where's the proof of his coming? And that is, again, everybody trying to discredit God altogether.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that is where we're at, y'all. Mm-hmm. That is where we're at. And it is rapidly getting worse.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Today, if you don't, you would have to acknowledge that. Even it doesn't matter where you fall on the God topic, is that there is seems like a push to discredit the existence of God.
Yes.
Yep. Absolutely. There's absolutely a push inside of our society to do that right now. But the gospel of Christ will completely envelop the world. That's what he tells us, that Jesus in Matthew 24:14, he says that this will be a testimony to all the nations.
Amen.
And then the end will come.
Yeah.
And then the end will come. But again, we are to look in the days of Noah. So when mankind begins to discredit the flood and begins to start to cry out that there is no God, That should rise your suspicions.
Mm-hmm.
What's another one? What's another one that we can look at these last days? Acts chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you this morning that is taking place.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That is taking place right now.
Yes.
As we move forward. There are people who are not Christians that are having dreams and seeing visions of Christ's return. An urgency on these people's hearts, and again, they may not. You have to understand that when you're not a believer and God reaches down and touches you in your heart, we don't know how we would react to that.
Right.
We don't know. We may pick up this phone and make a video, and again, you're going to have a certain amount of people that are going to discredit that all the way.
Yeah.
But what is the message? The message is that Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
And that only a relationship with Him, that relationship with God that we talked about, that is the only thing that will save you, not your intellect, not your power, and not your riches.
That's right.
What happens when all three of those fail?
Yeah.
Now we have a problem, Houston.
Yeah.
Now we have a problem because, again, when you start to see people who are not Christian start to have these dreams, these visions, and begin to profess that Christ is Lord and that He is coming back.
Amen.
That is another sign that we as Christians should definitely pay attention to.
Yes.
And again, y'all, I say again, with it being a warning, please, if you have not ever accepted Jesus, let today be the day.
Amen.
Let these scriptures. God says, "My word is spirit." So when you read the word of God, the Holy Spirit will move in your heart.
Yes.
He will move in your heart. So when we start to see these dreams and these visions, so what's another one? Jesus tells us to look, and as the days of Noah become more prevalent, mm-hmm. that is when I will come. Mm-hmm. So how many times do we talk about that verse and not really go back and check out what was going on in Noah's day?
Yeah.
So let's do that right quick. We're going to go to Genesis. We're going to go to Genesis chapter 6. We're going to look at about four scriptures right here. Like I said, I know we're bouncing around today, and I apologize for that, but it is for a good reason. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. Now God had already declared, it had been 120 years, the sons of God had come down and began to breed with the daughters of the earth, creating a new type of being called the Nephilim, or giants, as you would call them. But anyway, you see this kind of genetic mutation happening in the times of the Old Testament. The sons of God began to come down and not only breed with the daughters of the earth, but they took them as their wives. It says as many as they wanted. So you see this kind of disregard for the marriage or the sanctity of it anyway between a man and a woman because the fallen had come down and were wreaking havoc on this planet. And us being in our simple minds, again, just like in Noah's day, we have entered into a time of that as well.
Yes.
In 2018, there was two genetic twins that were born in the country of China that had been genetically altered to be more than human.
Yeah.
They had the chromosomes of not two, but three parents. I don't know if you're aware of this, but you are now. Understand that the times we are living in, brothers, heed this warning of God.
Yeah.
Yes.
And know that the end is closer than you think.
Yep.
We're almost home.
Yes, we are.
Yes.
Come
on.
But sometimes that can be a little terrifying. So again, that genetic mutation, that desire to do that, that is straight from the devil.
Yep.
Yes.
And it can be disguised as a good thing because we'll hear that cures will come from this and possibly cancer and dementia and Alzheimer's, and those are all true. But where is the line?
Yeah. Yeah.
Where is the line where we go, you know what? This is not right. We cannot do this.
Amen.
There is a line in which humanity should not cross.
Amen.
Right.
Exactly.
And just like in Noah's day, we have just crossed that line. And if you think America's not in on it, in 2019, November of 2019, the first Russian-born scientist in America actually did not birth a baby, but actually injected the DNA of three parents into an embryo inside of America.
Lord, forgive us, Lord.
So that is in that. Now, here's the other part of this, is that there is actually policies in American politics that keep the gestation period of the embryo to 7 days and below. So that's policy on how to kill a kid. So we'll let you do it, but only till 7 days, and then you got to kill that baby. And you may say it's just an embryo and that, you know, all of these things, but murder is murder, y'all.
That's right.
Murder is murder. Jesus wasn't even born yet. He walked in and his cousin was in the womb and leapt in the womb when he came any closer. The sanctity of the womb and birth is straight from God.
Yes.
So again, this is breeding of the human species had been corrupted. And now God had declared 120 years from now, Noah, I'm going to put an end to all flesh. So Genesis chapter 6, verse 5 reads like this. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the thoughts of his heart right there too. So now we should pay attention to this corruption of the human heart and where all day, every day, it's just evil continually. It leaves God completely out and just wants to pursue your desires and your lustful flesh.
Yep.
And that's because we're all born into that natural sin nature.
Yeah.
That's the way we're born.
Yeah.
Through Adam, all of us received it. And only through God can we get rid of it. And not ever get rid of it completely on this side of heaven.
Right.
But we can be progressively sanctified.
Amen.
To where we get better a little bit every single day.
Yes.
Come on.
A little bit every single day. So there's another thing, that the thoughts of the heart were evil continually. So let's jump down, same chapter, Genesis 6, 11, verses 11 and 13.
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
Yeah, verses Genesis 6, 11 through 13. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, I have determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth. So they had been corrupted through their flesh. Their thoughts became completely worthless. And now their hearts were filled with violence. And another thing this kind of lets us see is there was a lot of people that thought they were good people in Noah's day. It was the thoughts of the heart, what they were letting entertain them, what they were letting administer to them around them at all times. And hey, y'all, I'm guilty as that, as of anybody. But that's something that we should begin to at least acknowledge.
Yeah.
That we have entered into a time, because there's a lot of people out there that would raise their hand and say murder is wrong. But how many of us watch shows?
Yep.
Or listen to music that glorify such behavior?
Come on.
And there's the thoughts of the heart right there.
Yes.
It's evil continually. And I know I know that's hard to do. Trust me, guilty as well. Guilty as well. I'll just be humble and say that right now. I'm guilty as anybody of watching stuff that glorifies the wrong kind of stuff. Now I try to do that, you know, less and less. But again, still guilty of it. Still guilty of it. In the culture and society we live in, it's very hard to get away from that. But I'm saying that to make a point. That we are in that time, y'all.
Yeah, gotta be careful.
2018, we saw the first birth of genetically altered children. And now and scientists, here's the thing, is you do have Christian scientists who are trying their very best to fight this because they know the dangers that come with this, and they are fearful of a genetic virus.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine a virus that comes in and gets you sick in your DNA. Mm. That's a terrifying thought.
Yeah.
And that's what they're worried about. That is the world that we live in right now. It is in the days of Noah.
Yes.
So that is how the world was prior to the flood. So then after the flood, again, like Peter said, is they'll try to discredit the flood, come and say, hey, where's the proof? He's not coming anywhere. Y'all just chill out, man. It's going to be all right. But when they start telling you that everything's fine and security, destruction awaits.
That's right.
That's what the Bible tells us. So this relationship with God, that is what we should pursue.
Yeah.
Amen.
We should leave the violent pursuits of our heart. And we should leave the thoughts of our intellect. And leave the comforts of our riches.
Yeah.
And be still. And know that He's God.
Amen.
Because He will touch us. He will move into our hearts. And He will give us comfort in this time. I mean, like I said, I want to know. I want to have confidence in salvation.
Yeah.
And that's available.
Yeah.
It's not that God is so far off into heaven. He is. But through His Holy Spirit, through His church, praise God, we can feel God right here among us.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord for that.
Yes.
Because, again, don't you think it's odd that the hamster wheel got shut down? You know what I mean? I say life in general, the hamster wheel just got shut down.
Yeah.
And we go crazy over it. You know what I mean? Like we're all spinning around on that wheel and trying our very best to go and do and to fulfill our life.
Yeah.
God just shut all that down.
Yes, he did.
All of it. Every single bit of it. And there are people that are affected right now in ways that have never before been seen. Our children today are entering into schools that are completely different. Because that's an argument a lot of people will say is, well, it's like this in every generation. Every generation has some kind of thing. No, not like this.
No.
Not like this. This is something that is completely new.
Yes.
Completely different.
Yes.
And that should be a cause for concern.
Yes.
It should. And it should put a burden on our hearts.
Yes.
At what point, if you truly believe something, if I believe that there is a semi-truck barreling down that road, if you're standing in the middle of that road, at a certain point, I've got to stop telling you a semi-truck's coming and I've got to tackle you.
That's right.
And get you out of that road.
Yes.
Every single one of us have loved ones that are standing in that road.
That's right.
And the Lord is barreling down on top of them.
Yes.
And He will come back.
Yes.
And I hope today that this puts a burden on everyone's heart to tell people the truth.
Amen.
Yes.
And that your money won't save you.
That's right.
That's right.
How strong your body is won't save you.
No.
That's right.
How smart you are won't save you.
That's right.
But let him who boasts boast in this.
Yeah.
Yes.
That you know and understand the Lord.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Ain't that, there's a verse in the book of James chapter 4, verse 5, that blows my mind every time that I read it. The book of James chapter 4, verse 5 says, "Or do you suppose it is to no purpose that the Scripture says he yearns jealously over the Spirit that he has made to dwell in us?" Oh my goodness. The God of the universe, Jesus, he's got all of this stuff going on. He's, you know what I mean? His thoughts are so much higher than our thoughts. His ways are so much higher than our ways. But he yearns jealously for us to come into a relationship with him. He's sitting up there and he's yearning. You know what I mean? That just blows my mind that the God of the universe is jealously yearning for us to come into a stronger relationship with him.
Yeah.
That is amazing.
Really?
And again, you can feel his presence even right now.
Yeah.
Yes.
And if you've never made that decision, it's okay. It's okay.
Yeah.
But the Lord will not tarry forever.
That's right.
Peter also says, he says that to the Lord a thousand years is but a day a thousand years. And the Lord does not delay his promise, as some would understand delay, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but for all to come to repentance.
Yes.
It's in the same chapter of Peter that we just read. Peter had a burden on him in that second letter to the church that he wanted the church to begin to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And through the gift of prophecy, you can feel the presence as the enlightening of Scripture in your heart. That is the Holy Spirit giving you that understanding.
Yes.
That's how you can go to a church service. You can hear a song and be moved. You can hear a sermon and feel like he's talking right to you.
Amen.
That is the Holy Spirit of God
moving
in your heart.
Amen.
And allowing you to understand the Scripture and to come into a stronger relationship with the God of the universe. Because he yearns jealously just for your heart. And he made that Spirit and put it inside of you for a reason. He yearns for you to come into his presence. Man, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And then we talk about this relationship. And it's like a child. It's like a child. That's in Mark chapter 10, verses 14 and 15. Jesus, his disciples are sitting around. He's been teaching. He's been doing all these miracles and everything like that. But he's been teaching in parables for most of the day. And then these people were bringing their children up. And they wanted Jesus to bless them. They wanted Jesus to touch them. And the disciples were like, "Hey, y'all get away from the Lord. Didn't you see he's busy?" You know what I mean? Jesus became indignant. He was like, "Hold up. Hold up.
Yes.
Let's take a break right here and focus on what we're actually doing. So Jesus, being Jesus, he says, he said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belong the kingdom of God."
Amen.
Amen. Amen, amen. I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. Ain't that awesome? He yearns to know you.
Yep.
And then his example to the disciples, when they asked him about heaven, when he was working so hard, doing all of these great things, he picks up a child, sits him on his lap. And to receive the gift of God like a child receives things, and they don't have any ulterior motive.
Yeah.
They don't have any. They just know they're getting something, and they're like, "Man, that's awesome! Thank you, God." But I can't help but to think about the proximity as well.
Mm-hmm.
How close is that child? A child is right there on his lap, right there. So receive as this child. That's how you get into the kingdom of God.
Yes.
Is that you are close to Jesus, not in some kind of religious, you know what I mean? Like I'm gonna say a magical prayer and Jesus is gonna give me a new car. You know what I mean? And sometimes again, like when we're my prayer that probably should use a little bit more time with it is when I'm blessing the food every day. You know what I mean? Like we all have prayers to where we're praying, but we're probably not praying with the heart we should.
Yeah,
you know. So God wants to get to know you in that intimate way.
Yeah.
He wants you to be on his lap, man.
Yes.
He wants you to be on his lap like a little child. So you know what he's talking about. And when you see that heaven open up, again, there's going to be a day, a generation in which that happens, and everybody's going to hit their knees.
Yeah.
That's what the Bible says. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess.
Amen.
But you're going to have one group of people who's looking up.
That's right.
Yeah.
I got it right there. You know? All right.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Yeah.
So again, we must pursue Christ. Yeah. And there are things in our life that separate us from God. God cannot, will not, is not going to be a part of habitual sin. All of us have sins in our life, and none of us are perfect, but there's a difference in being a slave to sin.
Yes.
And just making a mistake.
Yes.
There's a big difference in the two, y'all. And,
yes.
And again, heed this warning of God this morning is that,
yeah,
that you must begin to move out of that habitual sin. Jesus
yeah.
says anyone that's a slave of sin will not enter the kingdom of God.
That's right.
So that's the thing is like whenever we get to know God, we need to really examine ourselves.
Yes.
And we need to get to know God and understand Him.
Yeah.
Not just know who He is, but again, understand Him.
Right.
And we can know the heart of God. We can know God intimately.
Yes, yes, we can.
He allows us to do that through our congregation, through reading His Word, through
yes.
prayer,
yes,
and through His answering of prayer, praise God.
Yes.
How many times do we fall down on our knees and say, "Lord, I need you now."
Yes.
Amen.
And then He reaches down and answers right
yes,
there.
He does.
We do not worship a God of dumb idols that does not speak back.
That's right.
God will speak back.
Yes,
he will
yes.
answer you. He will move right out in the open. And as our culture continues to be like in the days of Noah, and the hearts of men are just evil continuously, and they discredit God, they say there is no God, that God does not exist. As you begin to see that, the society will now tear away, and you will see this glory of God just manifest Himself right out into the open. But that also creates a burden on our heart. Not necessarily sadness,
mm-hmm.
but not necessarily joy either. Not necessarily fear. It's just a burden.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the truck is coming.
Yep.
Yeah.
The truck is coming. You can see this. Again, well, what happens when people that are Christians, they talk about demons and angels and all of these things that we fight in every day. And people in the world, they look at those and they say, "Well, that's just what you're supposed to say because you're a Christian."
Mm.
But what happens when people that are not Christian begin to say those things?
Mm-hmm.
That changes the game.
Yep. Yes.
And if you don't believe me, just Google rapture videos in 2020 and see how many people have had a dream. See for yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Christianity always accepts to hunt for the truth.
Yeah.
And that's what I hope that you do today. I hope today you pursue that truth. And that truth will allow you to help someone else enter into that gate and get to know God in a way that you understand Him.
Yes.
And please, today, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I beg you,
yes.
I urge you,
yes.
to please make today that day.
Yes.
Please make today that day. As we close, again, just think about the ways in which we can be still. And think about the ways in which Jesus jealously wants for our attention and wants for us to really be a part. He wants to be a part of our life.
Yes.
Yes.
You know, I heard someone say this week that there's a hole inside of everyone where the love of Jesus should be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They just don't know it.
That's right.
Mankind just doesn't know it yet. They don't know that that's where the love of God should go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that you're the love of His life. You're actually the love of Christ. Why? Mm-hmm. He looks at each one of us with that intensity, that intentionality, that intimacy. And just jealously yearns for us to come into a relationship with Him. So again, remember, we can know Him. We can understand Him. And we can grow in that relationship. Once we come into that relationship, then it can grow.
Yeah.
But if you don't ever come into that relationship, if you always are relying on your own intellect, your own money, or your own strength,
you'll
always fail. Every time. Every time.
Yes.
Not because God wants to yank the rug out from under you. That's not it at all. But because Jesus jealously yearns to get to know you, praise God.
Amen.
So as we go through our week this week, let us think of ways that we can strengthen that relationship. And again, if you have not ever come into that type of relationship, I want to urge you and ask you today to please do that.
Yeah.
It always reminds me of how much I desire to spend time with my child, to talk to her, to show her how much I love her and everything. And it just reminds me of how God wants us.
Absolutely.
You know, He wants that
Absolutely.
With us, just like we want it from our kids.
Yes.
And the kids want it from us.
Yes. All right. So... please join me in a moment of prayer as we close out. Father, we come before You today, Lord, and in Jesus Christ's name, please forgive us of our sins.
Yes.
Lord, we say thank You for this day and for this opportunity to come together and fellowship and lift up Your Holy Scriptures, Lord, and really dig into Your Word, Father, And Lord, we ask for Your Holy Spirit, Lord, for Him just to come into our hearts, Father, and for Him to just imprint Your heart in us, Lord. Take out our heart of stone and replace it with a heart of flesh, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
Lord, we lift up again the names on the prayer list that were mentioned before the service started, Lord. And we want You to just move in those people's hearts, Lord. Strengthen those who are sick, Lord God. In Jesus Christ's name, please be with the doctors, the nurses, everyone inside of our medical community, Lord, that are working fervently to care for those of our loved ones who are in the hospitals, Lord. Please be with them and continue to guide their hands, Lord.
Yes.
Father, we want You to lift up anyone who is dealing with depression this week. In Jesus Christ's name, Lord, allow them to drop that darkness, Lord, and come into Your light, Father, and really get to know You, Father.
Yes.
Lord, we ask that you just touch their hearts in a mighty way, Lord, and for them to again, to just have the newness of life and to walk in that truth, Lord God.
Yes.
In Jesus Christ's name, Lord, we want to say thank you for every blessing that you've given us this week, Lord. Thank you for every answered prayer. Thank you for every moving of our hearts, Lord. Thank you for every single joy that we've got to experience, Lord, because we know that all good things come from the giver above, Lord.
Yes.
So we just want to say thank you for that, Lord. We are truly, truly blessed. And Father, we ask that you are, again, with our leaders inside of our government, Lord God, and help guide them into making the right decisions, Lord. And Lord, we want you to come back to leading this nation, Father. So allow us as well to have a burden on our heart in Jesus Christ's name, Lord, to proclaim your gospel, Lord, and to tell people about what you did for us on the cross, Lord Jesus, and how you allow us to just drop the unrighteousness and come into a relationship with God. Lord, thank you for that sacrifice, and thank you for everything that you've done in our lives. And Lord, we ask for you to protect us this week. Father, as we begin to close this service, Lord Jesus, we ask for your protection, Father. In Jesus Christ's name, please watch over each one of us. Guide us through this week, Lord, and just shield us from the fiery darts of the enemy, Lord.
Yes.
God. We just want to rebuke him in Jesus' name. Yes. Lord. We have confidence that we belong to you, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
And we are children of light.
Yes.
And Father, we ask that you continue to pour out your light and your mercy upon us, Lord, and allow us to continue to grow in that walk with you in the coolness of the day, Lord God. Sometimes it may not feel like the coolness of the day, Lord Jesus, as hot as it is. But Lord, allow us to get into that, Lord. Allow us to just drop those distractions in life in Jesus Christ's name and begin to follow you and pursue you in a fervent manner, Lord, that would just bear the fruit of righteousness, Lord, in our hearts and allow that to radiate out into our souls, Lord, and completely change the people we are.
Yes. Yes.
So again, Lord, we say thank you for this day and thank you for everything that you've given us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right.
Well, I don't know how you're going to get out.
Brother, you're talking about... Yeah.